Let our praises remind all the darkness of how great and how mighty our God is. For the battle belongs to the Lord and no one else. We are standing in holy defiance. We're declaring aloud in the silence that the battle belongs to the Lord and no one else, no one else. We'll sing hallelujah for all hell to hear. Shout out Hosanna above every fear. Strongholds will crumble like castles of sand. We are marching on. We're marching on. Unstoppable kingdom advances as we take back the ground from the darkness. The battle belongs to the Lord and no one else. You're the banner we raise in the chaos. No, the gates of hell won't stand against us. The battle belongs to the Lord and no one else. The troubles, the trials, the shadows, the sorrows, the long nights, the hard fight. We are the prophets, the voice in the darkness, declaring the battle is yours. We'll sing hallelujah for all hell to hear. Shout out Hosanna above every fear. Strongholds will crumble like castles of sand.
Hey, good morning, Bethel Church. Thanks for joining us online today. I'm Greg Anderson, and I serve as president of Inspiration Point Christian Camp and Retreat Center. You know, Bethel has been home church for my wife Janet and me since 1990. It's a special place. We don't get there as often anymore because of the events going on out at camp. And there's a lot going on these days. I want to call your attention to a couple of things. As we approach summer, you might be thinking about, hey, that's the time when kids go to camp, and you're so right. We are looking forward to having our summer youth camps back and running this summer. And in fact, registrations are rolling in. The governor of Minnesota said we can operate at 75%, and while that's good news that we can be open, it's also sad news because we know that not everybody will be able to get in. It's not enough capacity for everybody who wants to come. So the point is this, make sure that you register soon. And we can tell you that camp is a safe place. Duke University released a study earlier in March, and they looked at 6,830 campers and staff members in North Carolina at camps last March through August, right when the pandemic was raging. And they found that in those 6,800 people's experiences, there were only 19 cases of COVID, and in fact, 17 of those came from outside the camp. There was only a spread of 2 cases out of 6,800. We know that because of the time we spend outdoors and the way that camp is designed, it's going to be a safe experience for your kids. But listen, it's not only for kids, for families too. We have 8 family camps this summer. Well, 4 of them are already filled, but we'd love to have you join us. Come on out and make memories with us. We call it Vacation with a Purpose. You'll have time to go with your family on our 480-foot new zip line. You can go on the climbing tower, swim in the pool, all kinds of other activities, including hiking the 12 miles of trails. We provide delicious food for you, wonderful chapel services, and opportunities for fellowship. We'd love to see you. And then, of course, there are things that are going on right now. We have a men's retreat the weekend of April 9th and 10th, just a Friday and Saturday, with Dr. David Viem as our speaker. The following weekend, we have a women's retreat. And my wife, Janet, is going to be speaking at that weekend on the theme, My Only Aim. And then one other thing I'd like to call your attention to, and that's our Hands to Help opportunity. We need volunteers to help us move things from Spitzer over to Twin Oaks, to help us get Twin Oaks ready for this summer. So whether you like to paint or work in the garden or landscape or clean, build something, we need your help. Would you call our office? Come out and join us, whether it's a day during the week or a 4-day stretch. We'd love to have you with us. Now, before we get to the sermon, you probably know that today is Palm Sunday. So we're just entering Holy Week, leading up to Easter Sunday. This week at Bethel is going to include Monday, Thursday services, and those will be interactive, and they'll take place at both of our campuses. Then we'll have a Good Friday service at Bethel in Fergus Falls, and of course, Easter Sunday worship at both campuses in Fergus Falls and Battle Lake. And please note that we've added a 4th service in Fergus Falls. So check out Bethel's website, mobile app, and social media for information on Easter Sunday and the opportunities this week. As I said, this is a special week. It's an important one, right? And Easter is my favorite holiday. Now we get an opportunity to begin following Jesus on his journey to the cross and anticipating his triumphant resurrection on Easter. Now we're going to hear from Pastor Rich as we continue our weekly Lenten theme, Places of the Passion, as we dive into Palm Sunday.
Hey, we're so glad you've joined us this morning for our Palm Sunday sermon. I'm Pastor Rich, and I'm so excited to share with you from Matthew 21. Palm Sunday is the beginning of Holy Week here in the church year, and so it's the greatest week of the church year, and we're so glad you joined with us today. This is the day when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. Many of you know the story very well. It's familiar. We're going to look at what it means that that Jesus is hailed as king. He comes in riding on a donkey, and he is not the king that the people of Israel were anticipating, but he is the king that they needed. You've got to remember the culture and what was going on at this time. So we have the people of Israel underneath Rome's thumb. Incredible, like, dominance and really humiliation for the people of Israel. Everywhere they looked, they saw the fact that they were not in charge of their own country, that they were under the rule of this pagan, godless foreign power that dictated how and when they could worship and really was basically controlling, you know, their country and their rule. And so they longed for a king to establish Israel once again to the glory days that they had under, like, King David, for instance. And they were longing for this, so they thought, man, maybe this Jesus will be that king. Jesus is going to teach us throughout the story, but we're going to see the story of him today coming into Jerusalem, riding on the donkey, entering as a king, but not the king that they were anticipating, but the king that they needed. The reality is that we have within humankind is this longing and desire to have a king and to be under the rule of a king, to have a kingdom that is ours, someone or something that's going to rule us, that will benefit us, that will help us. The question is not will we have a king or not? The question is, who will be our king and what kind of kingdom will it be? The question is, who is going to rule us? What kind of king? Whose kingdom will we swear allegiance to? The reality is that from the beginning of time, there's been a battle going on in the soul of mankind, and that is, who's going to be king? Who is going to rule me? Who will I swear allegiance to? Who will I follow as my king? There is within our heart this longing to be in charge, you know, and I can't think of a better way to think of it than the 26-year-old movie. Yes, The Lion King is that old, my friends. The young Simba articulates this longing that he has when he realizes that someday he's going to be king and what that means for him as he looks forward to being king someday. He says, oh, I can't wait to be king. The song goes, no one's saying do this. No one's saying be there. No one's saying stop that. No one's saying see here. Free to run around all day. Free to do it all my way. That's what we want. We want a king who allows us to do things the way we want it to be done, right? That's the longing of our heart. From the time that we are little, from the time we are young, we want the world arranged like we like it. Think of a small little child, a 20-month-old child. He grabs a toy, and what does he say? He doesn't say, oh, would you like this toy? No, he says those words that we know, mine. It's my kingdom as he holds all the toys. And you think of a little toddler picking up more and more toys that he can't even hold anymore and he can't play with any of them, but he just wants them all for himself, mine. That's what's going on within our hearts. That's what was going on within the people of Israel. They wanted their way. They wanted their God to rule in the way that they wanted him to. And God is coming to them in a way that they never could have anticipated, but in a way that they needed. And the same is true for us. They had heard about this Jesus teaching. They had heard about what he had done. They heard about his miracles. They heard rumors been traveling to Jerusalem about thousands of people fed, about the fact that he walked on water, that storms stopped when he spoke. And then just recently, just prior to him coming into Jerusalem on the donkey, Palm Sunday, just outside of Jerusalem, rumors that he had raised a man named Lazarus from the dead. Many witnessed to that. And so the feeling in Jerusalem is one of anticipation. It's one of excitement. It's one of hopefulness. Like, maybe this is going to be our king. Maybe this is going to be the one who will restore Israel to its glory days. He's going to make us not just under the thumb of Rome, where we got to grovel and serve them and be under their rule, but we're going to have control and be able to witness, and God will, and people will see that Yahweh is the one true God. It's going to come out different than they thought, but it was what they need. Our temptation is to remake God into our own image. The people of Israel were doing it. They wanted God to be someone who would destroy Rome and reestablish them as a national and political power, that they would be respected again by their neighbor, by their countries around them. Our temptation is to remake God as we want him. We want a leader who will give us what we want. The people of Israel did it, and we tend to do it ourselves. You think of our own culture and our own society here in the United States as we battle with seeing things around us that make us uncomfortable, and we go like, man, we don't want it that way. We don't want our country like this. We don't want this new way of thinking rising. We go like, man, we want it the right way. We want it God's way. And man, maybe if we just twist this, or if we turn this, or if we get this guy in power, this happens over here, and then it will be the way it should be, like the right way. And we think, man, if it only we, and we kind of go the way of power and longing for control. And God goes like, it's never worked that way before, where God's people or his church have achieved what they've done through might and power and manipulating things, but rather through service and humbly walking with God. It's going to be the way with Jesus. I think of, as we think about our issues in our country and the tensions that we hear and the energy that we see and that we see raised by political issues and the conversation and all the emotion that's being poured out on issues that are important. But sometimes I wonder about all the energy that's being driven to them. It's like people are looking to our government, to politics, to save us, really. They're talking with so much energy, like, and so much passion that it shows that in some ways people have begun to worship politics and their political party leaders as their savior. It's like, it doesn't work well. I think of Chuck Colson, who was at one time at the center of power, working in the White House in the West Wing, working for President Nixon when he was in the middle of his chaos and right before he was found out to be a part of, you know, the whole Watergate issue. And Chuck Colson then eventually went to jail for his participation in the cover-up of that. And so he came face-to-face with his own need of a savior, embraced Jesus as Lord. And he said this in hindsight. He said, "Salvation never comes aboard Air Force One." And that's what I think we need to hear. And as we're tempted maybe to trust ourselves in our political leaders, and we're trusting maybe in things outside of our Lord, and it shows by how much passion and energy and emotion that we contribute to what's going on. I mean, the reality is we see troubles in our circles. We see troubles in our country, things that are serious, and they matter, and they're important. But there's never a place for the follower of Christ for fear or hatred of other people. We take serious ideas, and they matter. But the troubles that we have in our own circles, in our school, our place of work, our home or marriage, it's really about kingdom building often. And it's about having our way and our longing to be in charge, to be the ruler. I think Christ is calling us to say, "Come my way." The disciples would be pressed there, and they wouldn't understand what was going on. But eventually, in hindsight, they would come to embrace the kingdom of Christ and go his way. So this question that we're facing here in Matthew is, who's going to be king? You know, it's a question that we face for our own soul. It's the question, really, of all time, is who is going to be king? Whom will you follow? What kingdom will you be about building? So let's read Matthew 21 text. Matthew 21, 1 through 11. And then jump in to see that Jesus is the king that we need. Maybe not always the king that we want, but he's the king that we need. So Matthew 21, 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you'll find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Here ends the reading. Jesus is coming in, and he is obviously fulfilling scripture. He is fulfilling what the prophets had said, and the people are shouting his praises. They're like, "This is the king. This is the king that we want. This is Jesus. Yeah, we know he's a prophet from Nazareth, but he is what we want. Finally, he's going to establish us again as a legitimate authority and power in our country, in our area." But Jesus has a different goal in mind. He has a different kingdom in mind than the people that are shouting his praises. See, my friends, here's where I want to go today is simply this, is that Jesus, he's a king that loves, but he loves three things. He loves by serving, he loves by speaking the truth, and he loves us by suffering. He loves by serving, he loves by speaking the truth, and he loves by suffering. This is going to go countercultural to what we want it to be. It was for the people of Israel, and it is for us. In a few days from this event on Palm Sunday, in a few days, he's going to gather with his disciples, and they had prepared a room on Thursday to celebrate Passover, the great Jewish holiday of Passover, where they celebrate God setting his people free from the Egyptian powers. And now they're thinking that Jesus will set them free from the Roman powers, and they're so excited. And Jesus, at this meal, he stops in the middle of the meal. He gets up. The person of honor, the rabbi, the teacher, the leader. And it says that he takes on a robe. He grabs a basin and a pitcher of water. And he goes to do what only the lowest in that gathering would do. He starts to wash their disciples' feet. And you can just imagine the tension in the room. It's like, what is going on? What are you doing, Jesus? And Peter goes, you will not wash my feet. You know, he gets all indignant and like, that's way below you, Jesus. You should not be doing this. Basically, he's saying, Jesus, listen to me. I know better than you what you should be doing. And then Jesus says, unless I wash you, you know, you have no part of me. Jesus is loving them. He's a king who loves by serving. It's what he would do. It says in the Gospel of John that Jesus, in this context of washing his feet, he knew where he'd come from. He knew what power he had, and he knew where he was going. So Jesus, it says that he knows who he is. He knows where he came from. He knows where he's going. Jesus knows what he's doing. He purposely shows them that he is the king who loves by serving. He's a God who serves, who comes to us and lowers himself. He takes on flesh, becomes human, and he serves. It's what he does. It's what God does when he becomes flesh. He humbles himself, and he shows us the full extent of his love, the Gospel of John says, and he grabs the towel. He starts to wash their nasty, dirty, dusty, sweaty feet. That's what Jesus does. He's the king who loves as he serves. He's the king that we need. He's the king who serves us by doing what we could not do for ourselves. Jesus said, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He humbly comes into Jerusalem on a donkey. You know, he wasn't gathering people around him. He wasn't like building his base. You know, he wasn't collecting followers on his social media page, if he would have that back in the day. But he's coming and he's serving. As he comes in Jerusalem, it kind of looks like, oh, he's building his following. He's getting ready, you know. That's not what he's doing. He is from a common family from Galilee. He's a guy who would spend years, you think about it, he's 30 years old when he begins his ministry. A decade and a half, he spent working there in his home, most likely as a carpenter. He was in humility serving his father. He came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He is the king that we need, and he is the king who serves. Jesus is that king. He's a king who serves. He's a king who loves us by speaking the truth. We have so much recorded of this week, that things that he taught and interactions he had with other people. I want to point out just a couple of them to you. One is that he speaks the truth when speaking the truth causes trouble. He comes into the temple he sees on the outer courts of the temple all of the trading that's going on and the money exchanging and people who are buying and selling stuff and animals for the sacrifices that are about to be made. And he sees all this going on, and it says that he's filled with indignation. He's angry. He's like, this is not what this place is for. This is not for a place where people can make some money. This is a place where people are gathering to worship God, where God meets with his people here at the temple, where his word is read and people respond to him and worship and praise. And it says that he drives them out. He speaks what is true, and he caused great chaos by driving them out, overturning the tables, causing trouble. So Jesus sometimes speaks what's true, and some of us like that story. We go, yeah, that's the kind of Jesus I like. You know, he's that guy. He's like, you know, Jesus getting after it. He does. He's strong. There's no kind of meek and mild Jesus, but there is the meek side. There's a strong side. Both are true. You got to see them both. So he does that. He speaks the truth when it causes an uproar, but he also speaks the truth when it causes his closest friends to be uncomfortable. All right? Think of Peter. We have Peter in the upper room, okay? The setting I saw about when he was washing the feet of the disciples there in the upper room, and Peter, you know, is interacting with Jesus, there's a question if someone's going to deny him, and Peter says, man, if everyone else turns away from you, I never will, Jesus. I will stay true to the end. And Peter says, and Jesus then says, sorry, Peter, you're going to deny me tonight, you know, basically before the morning time, before the rooster crows, you're going to deny me three times. And Jesus speaks what is true to him, hard words, words that obviously caused Peter great distress and angst at the time. He spoke the truth. In a few days, we would see that would come true, right? A few hours, actually. Think of Peter would end up denying Christ, right? Deny him three times, then the rooster would crow, and Peter says that he went out in great angst and emotion. Then you think about Peter's story as he traveled through, that Peter would eventually be reinstated once again. So Jesus speaks what is true to Peter when it's hard. He speaks the truth to Peter after his death, his resurrection, right before his ascension, when he reinstates him and says, Peter, you're going to feed my lambs. You're going to feed my sheep. You're going to be my guy. You know, you're going to be my follower, my disciple. You're going to be a part of the starting of the church. And so Jesus speaks what is true to his closest friends, even when it's hard for them to hear it. Then he also speaks truth at great personal cost to himself. In a few days, on Good Friday, Pilate would be questioning Jesus after he's arrested and brought to him. Pilate would say this to Jesus when he's being questioned. He says, your own nation and chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done? It's kind of like Pilate's going, look at your own people are turning against you. What's going on? Surely you got something to say for yourself. Is it true what they're saying? And Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from this world. So he could have easily sneaked out around, but he speaks the truth to Pilate at great personal cost to himself. Continuing with the story, Pilate says to him, so you are a king? Jesus answered, you say that I'm a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I've come into the world to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who's of the truth listens to my voice. Pilate said to him, what is truth? Oh, fascinating question, isn't it? Jesus is speaking what is true. He's pointing Pilate to beyond what's going on here and pointing to Pilate saying, there's a lot more going on here, Pilate, than you know about. Jesus is a king who speaks the truth. He speaks the truth at great personal cost to himself. He speaks it to his friends. He speaks it to power and when it would cause chaos. He's a king that speaks the truth to us. He tells us the truth about ourselves. It's not always easy, but it's what we need as people. Third thing, he's a king that loves us by suffering. and ultimately dying. The disciples and those following Jesus had such high hopes. You think of, they're like longing, like, are you going to restore the kingdom? And when they said that, they weren't thinking an eternal lifetime kingdom. They were thinking of the kingdom right here. Get rid of Rome. Finally, we're going to have power. We're going to be in charge. Just a few days, their king would be arrested. And something that they never imagined would happen happened. I mean, they saw Jesus cast demons out. They saw him undo death. They saw him cause blind people to see, feed thousands. To think that he would just go meekly and be arrested like that, it was inconceivable to them. They couldn't imagine it. That their king would be arrested. Peter tries to stop this from happening. Remember in Maundy Thursday in the garden when they're praying, and then the high priests and the rulers come with them with guards, and Peter draws his sword, which means like he was kind of thinking some bad stuff might happen, right? He comes armed. He draws his sword and he strikes at the high priest servant named Malchus, obviously aiming for him with a sword, and he misses his head, misses his neck, cuts off his ear. Peter's going the way of power. He's going the way of, I'm going to establish, I'm going to make things happen. He misses his neck, but he cuts off his ear. Jesus puts his ear back on to Malchus. It heals him, and he tells him, Peter, put away your sword. Should I not drink the cup the Father has given me? He's telling Peter, should I not suffer and die? You want to go the way of the sword. You want to go the way of power. And I'm going the way of suffering and death. I mean, I want to think about this. I think we know the story so well. Here's the problem. We know it so well that we forget to really think about it. But here's something I think that we need to, why in God's providence, why did he pick this time in history to send Jesus, to send his son, to become flesh at this time in history? I mean, the people of Israel have been waiting for hundreds and hundreds of years for the Savior. There's no prophets coming. There's very books written. You know, the Old Testament, you know, is silent. God has been silent for hundreds of years, hundreds of years. And then God decides when his people are under Roman rule, one of the strongest, you know, governments they had, you know, they were just a military powerhouse. And God sends his servant, his son at this time. Why, when they had in place this brutal form of execution called crucifixion? This form of terror, really, that was used as a tool to enforce their authority and their control and their power. Jesus comes, God sends his son to us in this time on purpose, very much aware of what he's doing. It's no accident, my friends. He is here to establish his kingdom, which will be completely opposite of what the people of Israel were thinking was going to happen, but it was what they needed. They wanted a king of power and authority, a king to set them free from Rome. They send them, God sends his son Jesus, a king who suffers and dies, and he calls his followers to join him in his kingdom, where our leader is one who has suffered and died. He calls us to join him in his kingdom, a kingdom of repentance and faith. Repentance is a form of death. It's a form of saying, God, you're right. It's a form of absolute coming to the end of ourselves and saying, God, you are right about what you say about it. It's a kingdom. He invites us to a kingdom where we're dying to ourselves, a kingdom of serving others by giving our life away. His kingdom that calls us to give ourselves to one another, to give our life away for those who hate us, for those who think we're doing wrong. He calls us to give ourselves away in mission, to give ourselves to a kingdom of grace, a kingdom of forgiveness, a kingdom of love, of kindness, a kingdom that is strong, but not strong in the way of power or authority, but strong in the way of dying for one another, serving, giving ourselves to one another, giving ourselves to those who think we're fools, strong enough to say, not my will, but thy will be done. It's the way of our Lord, the suffering King who calls us to his kingdom to come and to suffer with him. Our King is drinking the cup of wrath of his Father to deal with the rebellion of the entire human race against his authority, against his rule. He comes to us as the King who loves. He loves us enough to give himself to death on a cross, and he calls us to follow him, to take up our cross, to die to ourselves for the good of our neighbor out of love for our Lord. It is a love that is strong. It's not weak. It's not being soft. It's a love that is strong. But it's a love that serves. It's a love that speaks what is true. It's a love that suffers for and with others. He is the King that we need. He is your King. Let's pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you that you are indeed the King that we need. Lord, we're so prone to want to be in charge. We're so prone to want to be king, to have a kingdom of power. Our pride wants to rule. We forget that you call us to walk, to follow in your path as a King who loves, who suffers, who dies. So forgive us. Thank you that your kindness and grace, you call to us once again to follow after you. We say thank you, and we follow. In your name we pray. Amen.
Bethel, thanks again for joining us today. I want to encourage you to dig in deeper with God and with those people around you. Pastor Rich has provided some discussion questions to help you do that, so walk through them on your own or with your family or with your small group. You can also participate in the mission of Bethel through your giving, as you give online or by mail. And your giving, Bethel, makes a huge difference locally, at places like Inspiration Point, and around the globe. So thank you. Thanks so much for joining us today. Thank you for joining me at Twin Oaks Lodge here. And we look forward to seeing you again next week.